Hi, my name is Todd.
And I'm Ross. We are two of the engineers here at API.
We're going to show you how to retrofit the moving fader automation system into the API 1608. We have a standard frame as it comes from the factory with the manual faders, and this is the console we're going to automate today.
When your retrofit kit arrives, what you'll find in the box is two FCM assemblies, or two more if you have an expander frame as well. You also have an ACM assembly. You'll have a memory card and memory card reader. You'll have the back panel with power connections and other data connections, and also an additional panel if you have an expander frame. You'll also have a power supply brick and AC power cable. You will also have the MIDI cable for connecting the DAW interface. And finally, you have a piece of foam for protecting the meter bridge of the console.
To perform the installation, you require some tools. We're going to need a number one Phillips screwdriver, diagonal cutters, some pointy-nosed tweezers, or a dental pick tool will work, an X-Acto knife, the 1608 module extraction tool that should have come with your console, a soldering iron with solder, some bus wire, 30 gauge or 28 gauge will do, and a multimeter.
As part of this installation, we'll need to turn the console upside down. So as a first step, turn the power off and then remove all connections from the rear panel. Before flipping the console, we need to remove a number of things from the frame. You want to take out the top and the bottom screws from many of the modules. This includes the master section modules, the echo return modules, and all 16 input modules. You'll also need to take out the top and bottom screws from each of the fader panels. When removing the modules, you want to start with module number one. This is at the left end of the console. The first step is to remove the screw that is in the middle of the faceplate and is located between the switches labeled 5, 6, and pre. Once the screw has been removed, you'll use the module extraction tool and insert it into the hole. You want to make sure that the hook is completely inside of the panel and that the tool is now at an angle with respect to the faceplate. To pull the module out, you should use a rocking back and forth motion. Once the module pops free of the connectors, you can simply lift it straight up. Once the module's out of the console, be sure to replace the screw that you removed to keep the module together. Once one or two modules have been removed using the extraction tool, you can simply reach inside the console to pop the module up from underneath. This is much easier and much quicker.
When removing the channel fader panels, remove the fader cable along with the panel. But when removing the program fader, disconnect the cable from the fader and leave in the frame. Now it's time to flip the console over. We strongly recommend doing it onto the ground for safety reasons, and also use the piece of foam to protect the meter bridge from scratches. Once the console is flipped over, remove the center rear and center middle bottom panels.
Now it is time to take the new automation power and data rear panel assembly and feed the cables through the console. What you'll need to do is feed the cables under the first extrusion, over the motherboard, and then under the next extrusion. All of the wires, except for two FCM power wires, will end up here in the master area of the fader bay. Once your cables are routed, they should look like this. and the rear panel assembly should be standing up in preparation for the next step. Next, remove the console's main power distribution and link panel. Carefully flip it forward to expose the power distribution board. There are two wires on the automation power distro board that connect over to the main console's power distro board. They are here and labeled chassis and 5-volt ground. The 5-volt ground is the black wire, which connects to the screw terminals, which are labeled the same in three places here, you only need to choose one, on the main console's power distro. The chassis wire connects to one of the PCB mounting screws that can be found in the corner. This is what your connection should look like when finished, the 5-volt and chassis wires. Shown here is a revision C power distribution board. If you have a revision D board, there will be dedicated screw terminals for the chassis and 5-volt ground connections. Next, replace the three bottom panels and make sure that all the screws are tight once they're installed. The next step is to flip the console back over.
Now that the console is back right side up, it's time to make the connections to the automation controller module. We recommend placing a piece of cardboard on the frame so as to protect the panel when making these connections. The first thing to connect is locate the 6-conductor power wire labeled ACM. We will solder these 6 conductors into the 6 pads located on the corner of the main board. Be sure to match colors with the silk screening labels on the printed circuit board and make sure you get good solder flow. You can see here the 6 wires soldered to the pads and the printed circuit board color labeling: black, red, green, white, blue, and brown. You can see here the finished power wire soldering with the colors matched up to the labeling on the printed circuit board. This is a very critical step, as mistakes in wiring can damage the printed circuit board assemblies. We understand that choosing to solder the power can be a bit inconvenient, as it takes a little more time and skill to install and remove these assemblies, but we feel the trade-off in rock-solid power connection with no chance of increased resistance and intermittency is worth the extra time and effort. Now let's finish making the rest of the connections to the ACM module. Taking the insert control cable, it plugs down to P15 on the motherboard. The fader cable, which we left earlier when we removed the manual fader, plugs in to P40 on the ACM panel. MIDI 7 plugs to J19 on the ACM panel. MIDI 3-4 plugs to J18. MIDI 1-2 plugs to J16. Data 33 through 48 plugs to J14. And data 17 through 32 plugs to J13. With all connections in place, forgot one. The linear time code plugs up to J10. Take the cable that's connected to J11 and run it across the fader bay towards the channel faders. With all connections in place, you're ready to place this panel into position. Now we move on to the 8-channel fader module. These modules are not unique, so you can use either module in either location. Just like with the ACM module, we begin by connecting the power. You locate the 6-conductor cable labeled FCM2 and bring it to the 6 power pads of the FCM Matching up colors, as this, again, this is the critical step in solder, just as with the ACM. With the power wire soldering complete, you're ready to make the remaining connections for the fader controller module. The module comes with 8 new fader wires, which plug into the motherboard in the 8 locations where the manual faders had been connected. Simply plug them in sequence across, like so. And finally, the data connection from the ACM. Locate the data cable labeled FCM2 and plug it into J6. Now this module is complete and ready to be placed into the frame. Repeat the same steps for your other FCM and you'll be ready to go.
Moving on, we need to make modifications to each of the 16 input modules, as well as the program ACA module. To open up the input module, first lay it on its side and remove the 4 screws. The PCB assembly simply slides out of the chassis and folds open like a book. First thing you want to do is locate the insert push switch, which is S1B. What we're going to do is we're going to take the tweezers, or dental pick, and remove the latching pin from the switch. We remove the latching pin by getting the point of the tweezers underneath it and prying up until the pin should pop out. The next step is to locate R11B, which is this jumper right here. We're going to use the diagonal cutters and cut out this component from the PCB. The next step is that we want to look at location J7B. That's going to be right here on the circuit board. There is no component soldered into it. If you flip the board over, that location here is right next to the text that says mute. We're going to use our X-Acto knife and cut the small trace, which is located between two of these pads. As you do this, you want to make sure that you don't cut any other traces besides that one. Once we've cut the trace, you want to use your multimeter to double check that there's no continuity between the two pads. The final step, if we flip the board back over to show the component side, we want to look at location P9B, which is here. Again, this does not have any components soldered into it. If we use our multimeter probes, we want to check that there is continuity between the two pads of P9B. On some early revisions of the board, you will need to solder in a jumper between these two pads. So here we can see P9B with a jumper added. We now want to put the module back together by folding over the PCB. We're going to insert the white switch caps through the holes in the chassis. Push down gently so that the holes in the PCB line up with the threaded standoffs underneath. We're then going to put the 4 screws back in to hold everything in place. We will need to repeat this procedure for the other 15 input modules, and more if you have an expansion console as well. We also need to modify the 268B, which is the program ACA and booster module. Looks like this. We lay it down on its side. We can open it up again by removing 4 screws. If we fold over the PCB to reveal the component side, we simply need to look at R109B, which is a jumper, and also S3B, which is on the edge of the board here. We will do much of the same procedure as we did with the input modules. We are going to pull out the latching pin of the switch and cut out R109B. We're going to remove the latching pin by placing the tip of the tweezers underneath it and prying up so that the pin will pop out. We then simply grab the pin and remove it. We're going to use the diagonal cutters to cut out R109B and remove it.
We're almost done, but before we're ready to power anything up, we have to do some final checks with the multimeter just to make sure we got those power and ground wires connected correctly. In order to perform these tests, we have to reconnect the console main power supply, as well as connect the automation power supply to our new power data panel that we installed. It's critical that both power supplies are connected to outlets that share a common ground, but also note that the automation power supply does not have a power switch, so it's also critical that these outlets are switched off at this time. The first test we will perform is a continuity check with the power wires on our new automation modules. It's critical that this test is performed before applying power from either power supply. Set your multimeter to continuity, so you have the continuity beep. Using the black lead, use the chassis pad on the channel motherboard as reference. Then, on each of the three automation panels, pivot them up and measure continuity. You should receive continuity from 4 of the 6 pads if all your grounds are correct. So P1, the black wire, will have continuity. P2, the red wire, may begin with continuity but will stop quickly. P3 will have continuity. P4, the white wire, again, may beep initially, but then should not. P5, the brown wire, will have continuity. And P6, the blue wire, will have continuity. Again, perform this check for all 3 of your automation panels. If you fail to get continuity on several of your ground points, it's possible that your power supplies are not properly grounded together. Check that first to make sure that the 2 outlets that you're using share a common ground. For the next test, we will apply power to the automation power supply only. Set your multimeter to DC volts, and again, use the chassis pad on the channel motherboard as your reference. And then we're going to measure DC volts on each of the 6 automation power wire locations. We want to perform this test on each of the 3 modules. So let's go ahead and apply power. The faders will likely jump at the initial power connection. And then we want to measure DC volts again. The ground pads should measure less than 0.1 of a volt. And the power pads should measure between 12 and 12.5 volts. So we go to P1, the black wire, a ground pad, and we get less than 0.1 of a volt. P2, the red wire, 12 volts. P3, the green wire, less than 0.1 of a volt. P4, the white wire, 12 volts. P5, the brown wire, 0 volts. P6, the blue wire, again 0 volts. As a final check, we want to measure DC volts on each of the 3 motherboards inside the frame as powered by the main console power supply, just to make sure everything's still in the right place. So we'll turn the power supply on, and again with the multimeter set at DC volts, and again, using the chassis pad on a channel motherboard as the reference, we will work our way across each of the 10 power connections on each of the motherboards. Their voltages are labeled on each of the motherboards. So we'll start 16 volt ground. We get virtually 0. plus 16 volts. 16 volts within a volt is acceptable. 24 volts. 24 volt ground, virtually 0 volts. Plus 5 volts. Plus 48 volts. 5 volt ground. 16 volt ground again. Minus 16 volts. And then finally, 48 volt ground. With the three power tests complete, we're ready to reinstall the modules. First, turn off both power supplies, and then begin inserting modules from the right furthest location first, and you work your way across the console. The multifunction module is the first module, the 840B. If you forget what order they go in, the motherboard has the slot labeled with the module model numbers. With all your modules back in the frame and all your screws tightened, you're ready to go. Power up your power supplies, the console and the automation. Order is not critical.
You'll also want to test the whole system to make sure that it was installed correctly. First thing to do is to make sure that all the faders are moving and that all the faders respond to touch. You also want to make sure that all the mutes and inserts for the channels are functioning properly, since they're now under automation control. Finally, you want to make sure that all the channels are passing audio correctly. A detailed procedure for testing is included in the installation manual.
We hope you've enjoyed our video here today showing you how to install the automation into the 1608. If you have any further questions when doing your install, you can always contact tech support here at API. We hope you enjoy your 1608 for many mixes to come.